Hello everyone, at the end of this video, you should be able to describe various metabolic adaptations that occur in fasting and starvation. Fasting begins if no food is ingested after the absorptive period, that is 2 to 4 hours after a meal. And if it is prolonged more than 2 days, it is called as starvation. In the absence of food, plasma level of glucose, amino acid and triacylglycerol falls, which triggers decrease in insulin and increase in glucagon release. Decrease in insulin to glucagon ratio and decrease availability of circulating substances make a period of nutrient deprivation a catabolic period, which is characterized by lipolysis, glycogenolysis and proteolysis. And this leads to exchange of substrates among various organs like liver, adipose tissue, muscle and brain with two priorities. First is to maintain adequate plasma level of glucose to supply glucose to various glucose dependent tissues like brain, RBC, adrenal medulla, retinal cells. Second priority is to conserve protein and to provide energy from the alternate sources like fatty acids and ketone bodies. Fatty acids are released from breakdown of triacylglycerol in adipose tissues and ketone bodies are synthesized in liver. We know that well-fed state starts after a meal and it lasts up to 4 hours. It is also called as absorptive phase. Early fasting starts after absorptive phase and it lasts up to 16 hours. It is called as post-absorptive phase. Fasting from 16 hours to 2 days. Starvation from 2 days to 24 days. And prolonged starvation more than 24 days. Early fasting and fasting, that is from 4 hours to 48 hours, that is 2 days. It is also called as early stage of starvation. 2 to 24 days is called as intermediate stage of starvation. And more than 24 days is called as advanced or prolonged stage of starvation. Early stage is characterized by glycogenolysis, gluconeogenesis. Intermediate stage is characterized by gluconeogenesis, fatty acid oxidation, ketone body synthesis and utilization, and advanced or prolonged stage is characterized by fatty acid oxidation, ketone body synthesis and utilization, and gluconeogenesis still continues for the exclusively glucose dependent tissues like brain, RBCs, retinal cells and adrenal medulla. Liver is the important energy provider in fasting. Glucose is stored in the form of glycogen in liver and this glycogen store exhausts in 10 to 18 hours after fasting. Gluconeogenesis begins 4 to 6 hours after last meal but becomes fully active as glycogen stores are depleted. Triacylglycerol are stored in adipose tissue and this is the important energy provider which lasts for about 1 to 3 months. Proteins, that is muscle proteins, are very important energy providers. Only about 1/3 of the body proteins can be used for energy without fatally compromising the vital functions of the body. There are 3 phases of proteolysis. First is rapid depletion, which occurs in early stage of starvation. Gradual depletion of protein occurs in intermediate and advanced stage, and again rapid depletion shortly before death. We know that in well-fed condition, brain is exclusively dependent on glucose. Muscle can utilize glucose, but resting skeletal muscle can utilize fatty acids. Liver is dependent on glucose for energy. Adipose tissues can utilize glucose as well as fatty acids, and cardiac muscle also utilize fatty acids and glucose for energy. In the early stage of starvation, brain uses glucose for energy. And other organs like muscle, liver, adipose tissue and cardiac muscle use fatty acids as source of energy. In the intermediate stage, ketone bodies and glucose are utilized by brain. Fatty acids are utilized by liver and both fatty acids and ketone bodies are utilized by skeletal muscle, adipose tissue and cardiac muscles. In the advanced stage, ketone bodies and glucose are the source of energy for brain and fatty acids are the source of energy for other organs like muscle, liver, adipose tissue and cardiac muscles. The initial stage, which is also called as early stage of fasting, lasts up to 2 days of calorie intake. and it is characterized by decreased level of glucose, decreased level of insulin and increased level of glucagon. Liver plays a very dominant role here in the initial stage of fasting, and it ensures maintenance of blood glucose level within normal limits, and it provides glucose to various glucose dependent tissues. Just as insulin signals the fed state, glucagon signals the starved state. The main target of glucagon is liver, and it causes glycogenolysis by causing phosphorylation and activation of enzyme glycogen phosphorylase, and it decreases glycogenesis, that is glycogen synthesis, by inhibition of enzyme glycogen synthase. The glucose which is formed by glycogenolysis is then released from liver into the blood, and it is taken up by organs which are exclusively dependent on glucose, like brain, RBCs, adrenal medulla, retinal cells. So this glucose is taken up by the brain and completely oxidized to carbon dioxide and water. It's also taken up by red blood cells, and lactate is formed by anaerobic glycolysis. Due to low insulin level, entry of glucose in adipose tissues and muscle is inhibited, because GLUT4 transporters which are present on adipose tissues and muscle are dependent on insulin, and as there is decreased insulin level in fasting and starvation, there is no uptake of glucose by both adipose tissues and muscle. As the liver glycogen stores begins to be depleted, then gluconeogenesis begins. And initially, gluconeogenesis occurs from lactate, which is formed in anaerobic glycolysis in RBCs, and alanine, which is formed from coming from muscle. That is from Cori's cycle and glucose-alanine cycle. But it should be noted that there is no net synthesis of glucose by this process using lactate and alanine as precursors. It simply replaces glucose that had been already converted into lactate and alanine by RBC and muscle. Hence, for net synthesis of glucose, another source of carbon is required, and it comes from glycerol, which is formed by breakdown of triacylglycerol, and this glycerol provides the carbon source for synthesis of glucose, but only a limited amount is available, and that's why only potential source of glucose is carbon skeleton of alanine and glutamine, which is derived from breakdown of muscle proteins. And the fatty acids which are released from breakdown of triacylglycerol are utilized by adipose tissue itself for energy purpose, and also by skeletal muscles and liver. Glucagon increases the fatty acid oxidation as well as it decreases fatty acid synthesis. Now let's see the metabolic changes that occur in intermediate stage. It lasts from 48 hours, that is 2 days, up to 24 days. And in this stage, the priority of metabolism is to preserve protein by using fatty acids and ketone bodies in place of glucose as a fuel. And metabolic changes are aimed at, first, maintaining blood glucose level and providing energy from alternate sources like fatty acids and ketone bodies. There is no glycogenolysis, there is increased lipolysis of triacylglycerol, increased beta oxidation of fatty acids, and increased ketone body synthesis and utilization by muscles, heart, and kidney. Conservation of body protein is the priority in the intermediate stage of starvation, and it is accomplished by decreased protein degradation as compared to the early stage, and decreased gluconeogenesis as compared to the early stage of starvation. Triacylglycerol breakdown continues in adipose tissue, and there is formation of fatty acids and glycerol. Glycerol is used up as a precursor for gluconeogenesis, and the glucose formed is utilized by brain, but the glucose requirement is reduced in this intermediate stage by brain. And the fatty acids which are released in the triacylglycerol breakdown are used up by skeletal muscle for energy as well as by adipose tissue. Fatty acids are also source of energy for liver. Fatty acids are oxidized to form acetyl-CoA. In this condition, the uptake of acetyl-CoA in TCA cycle is decreased, as the oxaloacetate, which is the precursor और इंटरमीडिएट इन द टीसीए साइकिल इज बीइंग यूज्ड अप फॉर ग्लूकोनियोजेनेसिस एंड दैट्स व्हाई एसिटिल कोए कैन नॉट बी यूटिलाइज फुल्ली इन द टीसीए साइकिल एंड इट लीड्स टू इंक्रीज एसिटिल कोए पुल विच इज देन डाइवर्टेड टू कीटोन बॉडी सिंथेसिस. इंक्रीज कीटोन बॉडी लेवल इन द ब्लड लीड्स टू कीटोसिस एंड दिस कीटोन बॉडीज आर यूटिलाइज्ड एज अ फ्यूल बाय ब्रेन एंड क्वार्टर ऑफ द एनर्जी रिक्वायरमेंट आर मेट with the help of this ketone bodies by brain. Muscles can also utilize ketone bodies for energy purpose and heart and kidney can also utilize ketone bodies for energy purpose in the intermediate stage of starvation. In the advanced stage of starvation, liver continues to synthesize glucose and ketone bodies. The ketone bodies are now utilized only by brain and quarter of the energy needs of brain are met with the help of ketone bodies. Other tissues like muscle, heart, kidney, earlier they were utilizing ketone bodies as a source of energy in the intermediate stage, but now they spare ketone bodies for brain and they start using fatty acids as the source of energy in advanced stage. What is the role of kidney in prolonged starvation? 50% of gluconeogenesis occurs in kidney. Kidney has all the enzymes of gluconeogenesis including glucose 6-phosphatase. In muscle, metabolism of branch and amino acid occurs and it releases glutamine which is taken up by the kidney. And by the action of enzyme glutaminase, it is converted to glutamate and there is release of ammonia. And further, by the action of glutamate dehydrogenase, there is formation of alpha-ketoglutarate which acts as a precursor for gluconeogenesis. In starvation, there is increased ketone body synthesis which further causes ketosis, that is increased ketone bodies level in blood along with the ketone urea, and the ketone body dissociation leads to acidosis, that is increased hydrogen ion concentration. Ammonia combines with this hydrogen ions to form ammonium ions and these hydrogen ions are excreted in the form of ammonium ion through urine. And that's how it provides compensation for the acidosis of starvation. In the next video, we will study about regulation of metabolic adaptations in fasting and starvation.